This is home now.
I love this city. I love this city. I love, you know, I love... No, I love being a Wellingtonian, and I love telling all my pals back in the States that it's the windiest city in the world. Really, no, the windiest city in the world. They don't really believe it.
I want to ask why you're here, because you must get so many requests to come and talk to people, right? So why did you say yes to this one?
Well, look, I think it's important to give back. You know, I mean, we've been working here in New Zealand since 07. 05 really is when we first contacted what was at the time called Weta Digital. They've morphed into Weta FX, as I'm sure most of you know. Just came over and kind of explored that. But we've been here a long time, and it's worked really well for our production. I think our productions have served the community well here and served the film industry well here, but you've got to do more. You know, I was so inspired recently, I was telling you backstage, Jane Campion and I have got to be sort of pals, and she did this pop-up film school right here in Wellington where she went to Netflix and she said, give me money. I want to pour it into growing creative talent in New Zealand. And they did, off the back of Power of the Dog and the prestige that Netflix got from that. And so she was giving back, and I was inspired by that. And I said, how can I help? You know, can I come in? Can I lecture? Can I bring them over for tours, technical tours, and so on, for what we're doing? And yes, she said absolutely. So I got a bit involved in that, but all credit to her. You know, so the point is, we've got to do this. We've got to, if we want this industry here, if we want it to flourish, we have to make it flourish. And we've all got to sort of muck in with getting people trained, giving people opportunities. But I'm resident here, I'll be a citizen in a year. You know, I plan on making all my films here indefinitely. And I love the talent. Thank you. I love working here. I love the people that I get to work with here. But you know, we've gotta have the new people, and I'm not talking just about writers and directors. I'm talking about, you know, the tradies, the craftspeople, the dolly grip, the crane grip. You know, those are all art forms in and of themselves, and people have to be trained to come in behind. You know, because that kind of heyday of the Lord of the Rings films and so on, people are starting to get a little creaky in the joints. You know, we need the young blood. And, you know, people of that specific age that want to do this are looking at, well, where's the business?
I love your use of we, and you keep talking about we. Right. And you live up the hill, you live up Mount Vic, you live in Roseneath, right? And so this is, look at you.
Yeah.
So this is home now.
I love this city. I love No, I love being a Wellingtonian, and I love telling all my pals back in the States that it's the windiest city in the world. Really, no, the windiest city in the world. They don't really believe it. Normally, my wife and I walk a couple miles around the waterfront and back to our house in Roseneath, and I always run into somebody I know, or maybe somebody that's working on the film in a capacity at Weta FX or something that I don't know them personally, but they'll introduce themselves. And about the only time anybody ever approaches me here is when there's an actual pre-existing connection. I notice that when people recognize me, Wellingtonians recognize me, they'd be mortified to be rude and intrude on my day and ask for a picture or anything like that, you know. So they just walk by and go, like your films, and keep going. And I'm like, catch ya, you know. or they'll just walk by and go, hi, Jim. I don't know who it is, but it's cool, right? It feels like, it's like a big, small town. It's not like a, you know, it's got that feeling.
I want to tell a story. So I don't know how old she was, but she would have been turning 11 or 12, my daughter. And so a long time after the Titanic came out, and it was back in the days when you could still get a DVD projector, you know, we put a screen up in the backyard. Her birthday's in February. It was a beautiful evening in Auckland. She got all her little mates around, about a dozen roughly, and they watched that film in the backyard and they shrieked. What is it like when you tell a story that does that to people?
Well, look, it's very satisfying. Obviously, you know, that was a very, very difficult film to do. Not a lot of people at the studio had much faith in it. They had enough faith to greenlight it. I got to give them credit for that. But during the actual production, went way over budget, a lot of logistics factors. We had a set that was so big we couldn't light it. It was 750 feet long, and we were using every Musco light in Hollywood. And the Muscos at full extension couldn't see over the deck. It's like, you'd think we could have figured that out, but so we wound up using balloons to get the lights high enough, and this was one of the first uses of, they're quite common now, obviously, lighting balloons. But and we had a 135-foot high construction crane that we used to position a light over the set. But I mean, it's like, it was a nightmare. When I was writing the script, actually writing the story, before I even wrote the script, I read a book called Reviving Ophelia, which is about young girls on the cusp of early womanhood, really sort of coming out of puberty, and how their minds get reprogrammed by societal expectation to not be the wild free spirits that feel like there's any and every possibility for them. And they get conditioned by male expectation, parental expectation, educational expectation, so on, to fall into more traditional roles and so on. And I thought, this is an opportunity to tell that story.